name is Mike Sliney with Franklin Templeton Investments, and to give you a sense of where I fit into the financial industry, it's really my job at Franklin to really go out and talk to groups like yourselves, stay in very close contact with our portfolio managers, with our analysts, with our economists, and really deliver information on all of the issues and opportunities that are facing the market. And I think the challenge today with 20 minutes is, well, there's really nothing going on economically at all, right? I mean, if we think of, you know, energy, oil and gas prices, you know, just a year ago or a year and a half ago, the consensus was oil will never slip below 100. Today, somewhere around 26, and people saying, well, it'll never get back there. We'll see. Commodities. About just 2 years ago, gold. It's where you have to be. You should put all your money in gold. Of course, that has reversed course. We have China, emerging markets, interest rates, monetary policy, presidential rates coming up. Strength of the US dollar and how that's affecting exports here in the United States. Devaluation of Asian currencies, fear of an economic slowdown. Current market correction, volatility. I could probably spend the entire 20 minutes listing the things we could be talking about in this meeting, but as I'm going to take a pretty macro view today and then allow for questions to maybe dig a little deeper in that period, I think as I look in the industry and as I've spent time in this industry, there's really one thing above and beyond all of these things that I've just discussed that can impact our financial security more than any of them. And quite honestly, that is how we react to all of these worries. There's a quote from the founder of Franklin Templeton, which I use in a lot of these types of presentations, and quite honestly, I just love. And this is Sir John Templeton, an amazing investor, an amazing philanthropist, and founded our company with the first global mutual fund back in 1965, and lived to 95, passed just a few years ago. But as you can see behind me, for those that can't read, I'll read it for you. Bull markets are born on pessimism, grow in skepticism, mature in optimism, and die in euphoria. And I think that this is just such an interesting comment. Very simply, what Sir John was trying to say is, at the time where we feel that it is the worst time to invest, typically is the best time. And at the times that feel that we can make money hand over fist, we're talking to people at cocktail parties, they're telling us how they made 20 or 30 or 40% in some asset class, well, quite honestly, that's when we should probably be a little more conservative with what we do. And so today, what we're gonna do is first start off with this number, and I'll ask first off, what is this number? Let's start with the easy question. What number are we looking at here? 6.5 trillion. I'm gonna take a guess at what number this might represent in today's marketplace.
U.S. debt.
U.S. debt, we wish. Closer to about 18 trillion on the debt. But what we're looking at here is the amount of money, which I would call, you know, scared money. People who do not want to take any risk whatsoever. They want to put it in a deposit at a bank and they want to leave it there. 6.56 trillion, and that was through the third quarter of September. And so as we've seen even more money move to the sidelines because of this market volatility, this number is even growing. And if we were to put that into perspective, because when I think of 6.56 trillion, it's hard to even figure out how much that actually is. Here, what we have is a tower of money. $100 bills lined side by side in a row, and if we were to put that up next to the Statue of Liberty there, that's what $6.56 trillion stacked might look like. And the reason I like to talk about that is because it does actually have an opportunity for the markets and money returning at some point when we get through this volatility. But the challenge is if we take a look at the yields that are out there for this money, there really isn't a lot to get us to the financial goals that all of us are trying to get to. And so how about some of these yields as of June 30th with the Fed Reserve raising in December? We have seen them come up slightly. But how about money market accounts? Just putting your money in a bank account. I remember when you used to actually watch it go up month after month and see the interest you earned. Today, what we call the $10,000 truth, how about put $10,000 into an average money market across the country? That will earn you $2 over the course of a year. Enough to buy a cup of coffee and pick the right day. That's not every day. That's one cup of coffee for the year, right? 1 year CDs, which once you get past the intro rates as of June, again, these have moved up slightly, but you know, barely more than a tenth of a percent, 0.2%. And even when we get out to the 10-year treasury, that is lending the US government money for 10 years and accepting an interest, we're only getting about 2.36. That has moved down slightly. We're now at about 2%. And these yields just aren't enough to get us to where we need to be in our financial lives. And here the dilemma facing, and of course, the issue is, with all of the things changing around us, with changes in money market accounts, with changes in the economy, changes in the market, one of the things that I always remind people is, you know, those goals that we have aren't changing. They still face us in retirement. I was taught a number very early in my career, when I was taught to be the most important number when it comes to everyone's retirement. The number happens to be 50,370. Anyone have any idea what that number represents when it comes to individuals' retirement? The number, you'll see how my mind works a little bit here. The number happens to be the average number of meals a couple will eat in retirement. How about that for a number? Let's do a little math and push that forward. 50,370 meals. For those that want to check my math, two people times three meals a day times 365 days a year, average 23 years in retirement. Let's say we can spend $5 on each one of those meals, perhaps at McDonald's. My first thing I'd say, you won't live 23 years and save yourself a lot of money. But if we can do it in a healthy way, right? We're talking 250,000 to eat, and I would argue not eat very well. And that's exactly the point we're trying to make today. Despite the fact that it's so hard to get returns in investments, certainly guaranteed investments, we need our money to keep working for us, and that's the dilemma we face today. So taking a look at how we got here, I want to talk a little bit about what I started with, and that is just the emotions of investing and how that comes in to the economy, why that's created so much money on the sidelines. And I actually borrowed this from my 10-year-old daughter's riddle book here, and this is what I call seeing is believing. Question at the bottom of the page was, which one of these tables is longer? Well, you'll look at it, I'd say most of you would take a look and say, well, the one on the left is longer, as my daughters, of course, said. And despite the fact that I would do this and show this over and over again, they're the same size, still agrees. No, you're still wrong. You know, the one on the left is longer. And I think the reason I like to point that out is because in the market, perception is reality, right? We're not all the time going off what the economic numbers are, what the opportunities are, where we can be moving forward, but instead, listening to all the noise around us, thinking of all the experiences that the market has had in the past and bringing that into our decision-making. Availability bias, really just being influenced by the things that are happening around us without really looking forward. There are plenty of reasons to worry. You know, I listed many of them in the beginning of this presentation. As we look back through time, you can see a couple more here about what happened with Bear Stearns and the financial crisis. Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae, and just the problems they have and continue to have to this day. Too big to fail. Bernie Madoff. Unemployment, 2009, hitting over 10%. There are plenty of reasons, and will always be plenty of reasons to worry. And that really is what's driving people's perceptions and driving their activity. We did a survey at Franklin Templeton talking to all of our shareholders and asking them what their perception was of the market each and every year following the financial crisis in 2008, in which the S&P 500 was down 37%. And when we put the survey results out, it was pretty interesting, quite honestly. And that was, as we went year over year, in 2009, 66% of our shareholders felt that the market was down that year. 49% in 2010, 70% in 2011. You can see the numbers forward, but in actuality, we've actually had a pretty spectacular run in the market. If you were going to take a look from the depths of the financial crisis and to a specific date, March 9th of 2009, where the S&P 500 hit a bottom of in the 600s, and we've come up over 300% before this most recent market correction. But the perception out there is still things aren't that great. Loss aversion. What we call perceived safety may come at a cost. So many clients and people I talk to that are thinking about investing their money, I hear the same thing over and over again, and that is, it's okay that I'm not making much money in my savings account. I just don't want to lose any money. I've been through this, and I don't want to go there. And I put another number out there, and this is showing you money market rates going back about 10 years. You can see that right here, we used to actually have some rates, and this isn't flatlined, it's just so close to zero it looks like it is. But what I'd like to talk about is not just these rates, but these rates in real return. But what is real returns? That is taking a look at the rate you're receiving in subtracting inflation. Now, I actually even take some issue to these numbers here. Reported inflation is about 2%, or just under 2% as a matter of fact, when we look at the government figures. But there's a few parts of the economy that they don't include in this inflation number. Anyone know what those two very important sectors are? There you go, Steve. Food and energy. So if any of you happen to eat or drive a car or heat or cool your home, inflation for you might be a bit higher. But if you're paying for a child's education or saving to pay for a child's education growing at about 6% year over year. Healthcare, astronomical growth there. And so when we're looking at the real rates of return, when we take out inflation that we're feeling from these rates, one of the things we're guaranteeing ourselves by staying on the sideline, and this nearly $7 trillion is guaranteeing people who have money there, is that they will be losing not their money, but their purchasing power. And through traditional means of inflation, on average, it will take 26 years to cut your money in half. Not your money on paper, but what it can buy you. I was talking to my dad about this presentation. One of the ways I tried to get it across to him, I said, when you were, before I was born, you bought your first house. I said, how much did you pay for your first house? He informed me it was a duplex up in the Massachusetts area. He paid $16,000 for it. I said, what did you pay for your last car? $24,000. Well, there you go. All right, that's inflation. That's why we need to be getting more returns. And the biggest issue of all, of every person in the financial industry, of every person who invests, is something we call herding, and that is what Sir John Templeton was talking about in the quote of just people doing the wrong things at the wrong time. Well, this will be the most confusing chart I show, I promise. This is actually just showing stock market performance from 1990 all the way through 2015. And in this green mountain chart, which you see here, what you see is money either coming into or out of the stock market. Let's look at a peak here. That peak happened in January of 2000, right before the technology bubble burst. And so at that point in time, we never saw more money coming into the stock market than we had in the history of the stock market. Of course, that wasn't the best of times to add. We had quite a recession through into 2002 and 2003, only to recover and see the financial crisis. Now, here's the other peak I'd like to show you. Right? There had never been more money flowing out of investments than we saw in the midst of the financial crisis. People tend to want to get into the market when it's at its highest. They want to get out of the market when it's at its lowest. And this is the challenge that we have in the noise around us, everything that happens around us, in making bad decisions through these time periods. And so the market through the end of 2015, excuse me, that's a slide that's a little old, but not much difference in the numbers. The S&P 500 over a 20-year period has averaged about 9.9%. The average equity investor has done about 5.2%. And that really is the challenge that we have, not necessarily what's going on around us. It wasn't the financial crisis that made people have these poor levels of returns. It wasn't that Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac were having problems. It wasn't necessarily what was happening with interest rates. But quite honestly, it was people reacting to all of this and perhaps reacting at the wrong time. What may we have missed? What should we be focusing on as opposed to all the noise that's around us here? And I'll just touch on a couple of things. And I always say you can look at numbers on a quarter-to-quarter basis. I do look at numbers on a quarter-to-quarter, even month-to-month basis across a lot of different areas of our economy. But I think the trend is the most important to look at. And one of the things, of course, we know that the country is high in debt, as I touched on, near $18 trillion. But consumer debt is actually coming down. So while the average person had 13% of their income in 2009, paying off credit cards, paying off debt, now that actually has come down to under 10%, which is certainly a favorable number. It means more money will be able to be put into use in the economy. How about unemployment? Well, this is a number I know that we could argue, and we can look at different ways unemployment is reported and whether they're counting this group or that group, but looking at employment the way the government does report, you know, the trend has been very positive. Last year was a strong year, and job numbers continue to be very strong, coming from 10% down to 5% in the beginning of this year. Here's something that when I talk about, people still to this day will argue that we don't manufacture anything here in the United States anymore, and that's simply not true. We do have very high tech manufacturing. The way that this statement is true is if you look at the dollar amount of goods produced in this country, we are the largest manufacturer. We don't produce shoes, we don't produce t-shirts here, but we do produce airplane engines and pacemakers and things that tend to need a lot more technology, and we still continue to be a manufacturing powerhouse in that side of things. About corporate cash, what's happening with the health of companies out there. We've seen an average of 10% holding cash move up nearly 40%. We see balance sheets out there in corporations as strong as they've been in the last several decades. And one of the things that I think is very important is if we really back up and look at what's happening in the world around us, the middle class around the world, not here in the United States necessarily, is growing by leaps and bounds. And when we look at the middle class by the World Bank standards, that is after someone is able to put food on their table for their family, put clothes on their back, and a roof over their head, if there's money left over after doing that, well, in the world standards, you're considered middle class. It means you have disposable income. We've gone from about 668 million people to 2.3 billion people, projected to be 3.8 billion people, more than half the Earth's population in the next 10 years will have disposable income. And of course, one of the biggest things we've seen in the news is China and the China slowdown and what effect that's having on different economies. I'd argue that people are overreacting to both the Chinese slowdown and its effect on U.S. companies. But here's one of my favorite statistics to show. In 2009, sales of cars in China actually outpaced sales here in the United States, and that has never looked back. And if we look at this chart here, you can see through the end of 2015, a six-month rolling average, US about 1.4 million, China at about 2 million. But when you look deeper into why this is such an opportunity, here in the United States, 89% of us as a whole in the country own a car, you know, including if you're a couple owns one car, then you're included to own a car. When we look at China, do you know what percentage of Chinese population own a car? 7%. 7% of 1.4 billion people own a car. And with that 7%, they're already selling more cars there than they hear today. Some people think that this is just a China story. I'd say absolutely not. Anyone know what the top selling car is in China? It's a Buick. Interestingly enough, right? So this isn't a China story. This is a consumption story. There's a story going on in China, and it's true. Their manufacturing is slowing. And it's something that in this industry we've talked about for a long time. Average Chinese manufacturing worker makes $8 an hour. Average Mexican manufacturing worker makes $4 an hour. Less in Malaysia, less in Thailand, less in all of these other places. So to see people looking for this low-cost manufacturing leaving China should not be surprising. But the opportunity we feel they're missing is this new consumer, this new middle class that's being created. I can't think of anything more positive, not over the next 5 days, 5 months, or even necessarily 5 years, but I can't think of anything more positive to the global economy than 1.4 billion consumers coming online and buying products of companies that have distribution there. And so we truly feel that while China is being looked at today as an issue, long term, as they go through this transition, which they are going through, it is a huge opportunity. I know I'm running out of time here, and I know we have time to really dig deeper into to where you want to within the economy and within the markets, but I'd like to end really where I started, and thinking of where we are in the cycle of emotions in the marketplace. And you know, to look at what Sir John said and thinking, you know, where are we? Are we in pessimism? Are we in skepticism? Optimism? Euphoria? I can automatically take out the last two. You know, we're somewhere, I think, between pessimism and skepticism. And as we look out at the economy, yes, we see problems. Yes, there will be road bumps. Yes, the market will be volatile. But if we, as investors, can look past that noise and look to the long term, we've had 31 20% corrections since the turn of the century, 1900. Anyone know how many of those we came back from and hit an all-time high? Every single one. So if we can tune out some of the noise of the short term and focus on the opportunity of the long term, and we can get those true returns to the market. So thank you very much, and I'll hand it back over to our moderator. Thank you.